this session, right, whatever the next couple of hours is going to be, we are going to kind of really look at what enterprise strategy is, organizational strategy. So you should really know what strategy means. CIMA defines strategy to be a course of action, including the specification of resources required to achieve a specific objective. A course of action, including the specification of resources required to achieve a specific objective. So you have an objective, you have resources. How do you use those resources to get there, to get to where you want? That's strategy. Right now, even with the case study, this is what we are doing, right? You have resources, you have me, you have all this material that I'm sharing with you. You have whatever you've learned, your books, your revision content, all of that. So all these resources are there. Your objective is to finish the bloody qualification and become associate member or a CIMA exams qualified person by the end of August. So if that is your objective and you have all these resources, the way you or the route that you take, the way you get this done is your strategy. Corporate strategy can be complicated because there are multiple levels and layers and functions and types that are involved. So now, for example, if I just remind you, you know that the corporate hierarchy, there's the operational level, tactical level, and the strategic level. So what happens is, because you have these multiple levels within the company, strategy also has to be fragmented to relate to each of these levels, or else you can't, because you can't have one corporate central strategy and you can't call the operational level guy and tell him that strategy and this is what you need to do. That's just not how it works. Because something that is being discussed in the boardroom has to get translated into an operational subtask. The customer care representative, who is probably in the lowest tier in the company, is performing a very minute subtask that ultimately translates into the overall corporate objective. Something that is being discussed in a steering committee or the boardroom. So that link is achieved by fragmenting or by dissecting, dividing strategy into these different levels. So similarly, you have all these functions and types and layers to basically complicate strategy. But one could also say, no, this is not complicating. This is actually simplification, right? Because you are breaking strategy into pieces so that everybody, if you have 100 people in the company, each of them can do their relevant task and help the overall company achieve their goals. That's how usually, it depends, you know, either way is fine, right? I would take either definitions or either approaches. So the most commonly discussed model for strategy formulation is the rational planning model. This is something that I'm sure all of you are quite familiar with, the rational model. We'll take a quick look at it in the next slide. Among others, such as emergent, incremental, and freewheeling approaches. So there are different approaches to strategy, out of which one of the most common strategic planning models that are used is the rational planning model. And if you really look at the E3 syllabus, the first five sections, the topics that are discussed are also just different components of the rational planning model. Okay, this is a it's probably just good as a studying tool. As a studying tool, it's a really good model to use. This entire sketch, entire diagram I've drawn up is just the E3 syllabus. Further drilling down into the strategic planning model, so JSW, the three renowned economists, they took the stages from the rational model and grouped them into three main stages. Stage number one is strategic analysis. So under strategic analysis, external analysis, internal analysis, stakeholder analysis, and gap analysis. These are key areas or key analysis aspects you need to be good at. So now I want you to ask yourself the question, can I conduct these analyses, right? If I am supposed to start a business, or as you are runabout, if you're the new senior finance manager and you're trying to enter a new market, or you're just, you know, you started work, you've been appointed as a senior financial manager, can you conduct a strategic analysis on your business? Do you know the tools? Do you know how to use these tools? That's what the activity analysis sheet is. Therefore, that is why I've asked you to try all of those questions out, because you get to perform all of this in the exercise. So that's the first part. Second part is strategic choice. How do you choose? So when you want to choose a strategy, right? A way to go forward, you need to ask yourself a few questions. How do I close a gap? If there's a gap available, how do I close this gap? How do I compete? How do I grow, right? Growth aspirations. How can I divest, right? Can I expand? Can I grow bigger? Now, growth can be two types, right? One is just pushing the product. Growth in the top line, growth in the P&L, that is one. There's also non-market or non-related growth, which is diversifying, putting your eggs in different baskets, completely going into a different business. Right now, I saw there was this discussion about whether Runabout can, you know, just scale back and go back to the e-scooter business because we are only offering hoverboards. And if somebody, if a government, if the central government or if the local town councils or and authorities, they lift their permission given to us, right? Then what will happen? Or if they expand the permission for other companies, then what will happen, right? Relying purely on hoverboards, is it good enough? So there can be other questions to answer in such a situation. So this is how you, these are the basic questions you need to ask yourself when you want to evaluate a bunch of options and choose strategy. And the third is strategy implementation. And to help you implement strategy, there's budgeting, target setting, monitoring, and control. These are the sub tools that we generally use when it comes to the third stage of strategic planning, which is strategy implementation. So three stages: strategic analysis, choice, and implementation. Yeah? All right. Now, if you've noticed the co-activities, the second co-activity is all about the ecosystem. So a lot of questions, even last time, I remember Loshini had this really good question about whether we really understand what an ecosystem is. But what I want you to understand is that ecosystem is not a complicated idea. We are all part of an ecosystem, right? If you really take Earth, Earth is just one ecosystem, right? You can just simplify the entire Earth to be one ecosystem because every single human being living on the planet is in one way or the other interconnected, right? Something that happens, and COVID-19 is the best example for that. Me sitting here, you sitting in India, you sitting in Maldives, or you from Africa, or you from the United States, it doesn't really matter because we are all part of just one ecosystem. And this is the same story that is pitched when it comes to organizational ecosystem. An organization's ecosystem is made up of a network of organizations. So basically, it's just a network of several organizations. Supply chain, value chain, right? You name it. They're all just different words for ecosystems, including customers, suppliers, distributors, competitors, government agencies, etc. You can just list down any and all stakeholders, anybody related, anybody non-related, and plug them into your business and say they're all part of your ecosystem, right? So an organization's ecosystem is made up of a network of organizations involved in the delivery of a product or service. This can be through either cooperation or competition. And this is what ecosystem is. So don't alienate yourself from that word. Don't look at the word ecosystem and say, look, I don't really get what ecosystem means. It's just all of the stakeholders, all of the organizations, all of the entities that are part of the delivery of the product or service. So when Runabout is attempting to deliver the hoverboard, right, the hoverboard sharing service, any and all organizations, all the third party, our server providers, maybe Amazon Web Services, Google Maps, right? The moment we integrate the app with Google Maps, Google becomes a part of our ecosystem, right? Something that happens to Google directly affects us. And the moment that Google's executives are called up to the Senate for a hearing and they are put under data privacy restraints and that directly affects us, now what has happened is the US Senate is also part of our ecosystem because indirectly they are also affecting us, right? So this is what ecosystem means. The idea is that all components of an ecosystem impact on each other, creating a relationship that is constantly evolving and within which each organization must be flexible and adaptable to survive. So look, key words here, very important words here. Creating a relationship, constantly evolving. So all the components of an ecosystem are related. They can constantly evolve. They rapidly change. You even look at it in change management. Then flexible and adaptable. So think, is our company runabout? Are we flexible enough? Are we adaptable? It looks we are, right? If you look at the history of runabout, since 2012, we've made several strategic changes and we seem to have been making those successfully. So as a business, I would say that the pre-scene gives us a picture that runabout is a very flexible and adaptable company, which are positives, right? So these are definitely keywords that you can think about when it comes to strategy, when it comes to organizational ecosystem, flexibility, adaptability, relationship management, and continuous evolvement. Yeah, continuous evolution, so to speak. Right. Now, the thing about business is, right, I actually, something that came up in some of my, right, some of the students who have talked to me on the YouTube videos is this idea of value creation also. So everybody's talking about value. And imagine me, right? I'm offering you the product called the strategic case study. So my whole game, why you would come to me is because I'm offering something of value to you. And if I don't do that, then there are other options and you would be looking at it. And ultimately, why you would, among many, why you would choose one product, in this case me, would be because there is additional value that you can gain by working with me. So technically, value is inherent to any product or service, but the way you pitch value, the way you deliver value becomes very critical to ensuring business growth and business success. So value creation, knowing how to create value, is essential. Now, coming at it from the runabout perspective, we are hoverboard sharing, we are a hoverboard sharing company. Do you know, or can you come up with ways to offer more value, to create more value? Then comes the question, to whom? To shareholders, to employees, and to customers. These are the three key stakeholders: people who are working in the company, people who are buying from you, your users, and people who own you, right? People who are funding you, including the bank maybe, right? Because they're looking at a static value in terms of the finance cost, but shareholders, right? In terms of dividends and capital gains. So can you create value? Which is why value creation in ecosystems is a major idea. So in order to create value, first an organization must understand itself. So you have to have, now, say for example, I can definitely relate to this. I have been a lifelong pursuant of who I am. This is a question I've been exploring since I could probably just, since I really understood what life meant and, you know, what doing things meant, right? I have just been exploring. So understanding yourself, understanding the organization itself is critical in order to create value. And how do you do that? Through internal analysis. So there's a process, you might remember it. Now, one of the fundamental ways to conduct an internal analysis is to perform a resource audit, right? A resource audit. So if you don't remember, just, right, it's not something I want to go deep into, but just add to one of your lists to say, look, you need to read up a little bit on the resource audit. It's just an appraisal of what resources you have, right? What are the resources you have at the moment?
Wait, I will.
To, right? Yeah, what are the resources you have in order to deliver value, right? Just knowing what you're capable of. A resource audit can lead an organization to combine them and achieve competences, co and threshold. So since the day you started SEMA or whatever your accountancy qualification, I'm sure you have heard this word, co-competencies and threshold competencies, right? What you need to at a bare minimum perform and what you're really good at, right? Threshold competences are those that you just definitely must do at a bare minimum to exist in the market. Co-competences are those that you're really good at, right? Those that, it doesn't mean that nobody else offers them, right? There could be others who offer them, but you're really good at offering your core competences. That's why we call them core. So core competences and threshold competences, two critical keywords that you need to be aware of. That brings me to this. So knowing your competences is critical to identifying the critical success factors, CSFs. We'll take a look at CSFs as well, because the idea is that you're good at your competences, but you need to be good at critical success factors. So competences, especially core competences, are those that you're good at, right? You're good at something, but critical success factors are those competences that you absolutely must perform at your best, right? Possibly better than your competitors to critically succeed in the market. Right now, thankfully, we are a monopoly, right? Thankfully. So competition is quite low in hoverboard sharing at the moment in the 15 cities we are operating. But whatever variant you get, 1 second, one line, they can change that situation to say, look, the licenses have been revoked, or three other competitors have entered the market during the past 3 months because of loosening of restrictions. So we are no longer a monopoly. If suddenly your environment, your context changes like that, what you need to have a good idea about what your critical success factors are. And obviously you have a time advantage because you've been operating in the market for a very long time, which means you know the market better. You have had a first mover advantage for a significant time amount. So these things can definitely play a role. But still, if you're, come on now, when you think about PickMe and Uber in Sri Lanka, if you think about this, so you've got these two taxi apps. One is called PickMe and the other is Uber. So PickMe had this first mover advantage, but Uber definitely is the better app. And in terms of adoption, even though Uber entered the market later, the adoption has been way faster and way scalable in terms of what they offer, because they're really good at it. So just being the first mover is not necessarily a critical success factor, which is why one of your key activities in the activity sheet is identify critical success factors to ensure that you're very aware of what the CSFs are for and about. Ultimately, an organization needs to create value to its stakeholders, mainly customers. The value creation process is made easier when you know what your value drivers are. So another key word that you need to understand is value drivers, key value drivers. Every business has key value drivers. So what are Runabout's key value drivers? This is also something that you do, and we will discuss in Runabout's context. So how do you create value? By identifying and managing the value drivers. Considering the external environment is also critical, because any organization is always a part of a massive ecosystem within the macro environment. So internal analysis through resource audit is important. External environment analysis in terms of macro environment, industry, competition, that is also critical. And basically the first stage of the rational planning model, as I showed to you earlier, right? This analysis, external analysis and internal analysis. So we are just at the second stage of the rational planning model at this stage. The value chain and value system, right? You know what the value chain and the value system techniques are, can help simplify the value creation process. But ultimately, value creation is very unique to each business, as it would be for Runabout as well, right? Drivers of change in an ecosystem. Now, when you think about drivers, right, what drives change within a business, the idea is this: before we really think about what the drivers of change, before we drill further down into those points, what I want you to understand is that every decision you make in a company, right, almost every single decision pushes the company to change, right? Somebody will have to change. If you make a decision, somebody will have to change something that they're doing at the moment. Now, especially if you're working in a company, you know this very well. Especially if you're a manager, right? If you're in the tactical or the strategic level, and you're sitting in a meeting through the meeting, you came into a certain agreement and then you made certain decisions. Now it's time to implement those decisions. And when you communicate those implementations, you realize or you have to know inherently that people have to change, that the organization has to change. And therefore, it affects the ecosystem by large. So the ecosystem overall has to change. That is what we mean here. And main drivers of such change, when you look at, when you try to classify them, they can be institutional and systemic, social changes, market changes, technology changes, and sustainability changes, right? These are the five broad classifications of drivers of change. So institutional and systemic are mainly internal. They're quite internal to your business. If you're changing a process, something that is internal, you used to do something through five steps, but you're reducing it to three steps. Now things are changed. Those are institutional, right? And system related. Social is when people change, right? Your customers are changing. The general society is changing, reacting. Now, when Facebook came and the entire landscape of social media, what social media meant, what friendship meant, right? What friendship meant completely, the meaning of friendship got revolutionized. So that is definitely social change. And that impacted a lot of business. That impacted how advertising happens. That impacted how target marketing happens, right? So there's so much of ecosystem change. And nowadays, you can't really run a business without having a Facebook page. It's critical. You must have a, whether to what scale you use it is a different matter. But having a gamut of social media campaigns is very critical to business success nowadays, because presence matters. You need to just be in people's minds. Yeah. So that's social change. The market changes. So your competitors change, they react, they evolve, those kinds of things. Technology is definitely a digital a disruptor. So you most of the changes that we've seen at present are all because of technology. Sometimes a little bit too much, which, yeah, I mean, you know, it can be overwhelming. And of course, sustainability, right? Now there's a lot of talk about the whole residual forest being cut off in Sri Lanka. And, you know, we are going through our own drama about how the forests are being cleared, etc. But it all just finally comes back to the idea of sustainability. Now, for example, I was doing a research for Tokyo Cement Group. And they have a new cement product called Tokyo Super Plus, which is blended hydraulic cement, which is basically something that you manufacture by blending normal OPC, normal Portland cement, ordinary Portland cement with fly ash. So we have a coal power plant, and the coal power, one of the key waste materials of the coal power plant is fly ash. And this cement is made from that. Completely, the manufacturing process is completely renewable. So there's a lot of sustainability angles, and the story is being pitched to the market from that as well. So, you know, drivers of change, right? Even cement is changing. And what we've been using, I mean, Sri Lanka is addicted to OPC. So even, I mean, this, I definitely see that as a key driver of change in terms of sustainability and also social, right? Then the impact of factors such as those given below can be considered. So how do or what drives, what kind of impacts do we consider within these classifications of change? Factors like globalization, geopolitics, demography, all these generations, right? Generation X, Y, Z, etc. Empowering the customer, and digital disruptions like big data, automation, blockchain needs to be considered. So these are just a few key terms and commonsensical mostly, right? I'm not going to teach you globalization, tell you what globalization means, but when you frame your answers, these are definitely things that you, if you feel like it has a relevance to your answer, to what you're trying to write, you can definitely bring into your answer. Okay, just to show the examiner that you're approaching, that you're rationalizing your answer from a very broad perspective, because you give good consideration to knowing what the ecosystem means, right? That's the game, right? Convincing the examiner that you're taking into account all of these factors, even globalization, even geopolitics, even demography. Now, obviously, geopolitics can be added as a variant with a unseen, with one of the sub-variants. They can give you a reference material. They can pitch to you that the United Nations has done this. The convention was held and, you know, some things were decided. So we need to, you know, come up with something about transport. These kinds of things can pitch a geopolitical image to you that you can then translate back into your answer. Yeah. So these are some of the impact factors that relate to ecosystem change. Okay. Stakeholder analysis is also part of analyzing the ecosystem. The mission and vision are the foundation ideologies behind an organization that affects all dealings with stakeholders. So we know our mission statement to keep Zealand moving. Yeah, that was the mission statement, if I remember right. Many factors need to be considered when decisions are being taken within a business because it affects stakeholders in that ecosystem. Critical and fundamental factors are ethics and governance. So, see, now, why am I talking ethics and governance when I'm talking about stakeholders? That's because you can't do anything unethical, correct? Right? You can't really do anything unethical in strategy. So whatever strategy that you come up with has to, on one end, be ethical. On the other end, be in line with your governance aspects. So contextually, right, in terms of business context, it's sort of like before you do anything, you need to consider whether what you're doing is in line with your governance and if it's ethical. Because if it doesn't fulfill those two criteria, if what you're doing is not ethical, and if it's not in line with your governance code, whatever you've established in your articles of association and in your company, then there's no point pursuing it. If you do something unethical and you pursue it, you're going to definitely get hit later. So that's why it's very important that ethics and governance is sort of this critical prerequisite, and which is why CIMA gives such importance to ethics and governance. Right, and about 10% of your marks are allocated for that area. Stakeholders can be classified broadly as internal or external, or even connected versus disconnected, and even non-market versus market stakeholders. But mainly, the Mendelow's matrix can help classify stakeholders based on power and interest levels. Right? So I'm not going to go into detail about the Mendelow's matrix. So it's this classification based on power levels and interest levels. So you have all the four classifications, right? Keep informed, keep satisfied, etc., etc. So that is a tool in the list of tools that you need to maintain. That is one critical tool that you can definitely use. And I've already asked you in the activity sheet to conduct a Mendelow's matrix or stakeholder analysis as well. So I'm looking forward to seeing that. Stakeholder alliances can be created by matching needs of different stakeholder groups. So if you match different stakeholder groups, you can create alliances and get to where you want. And another thing you need to be careful when it comes to dealing with stakeholders is corporate political activity. It's key in managing powerful stakeholders that can influence the organization's existence and stability from a political perspective. Actions such as lobbying, messaging, influencing public opinion, donations, etc. can be used. So corporate CPA, corporate political activity, is a critical element in managing especially powerful stakeholders. Right. So that's a little bit about stakeholder analysis and stakeholder influence.